You are listening to Christian Audio's production of Women of the Word, How to Study the Bible with Both Our Hearts and Our Minds by Jen Wilkin. This book is read by the author. This audio recording was produced in 2015 by Christian Audio, which owns the copyright. No portion of this recording may be reproduced for any reason without prior written consent from Christian Audio. This edition is published by Christian Audio under an agreement with Good News Publishers, Crossway Books and Bibles, based on Women of the Word, copyright 2015 by Jen Wilkin. Please visit christianaudio.com, facebook.com/christianaudio, or twitter.com/christianaudio to offer your impressions of this work and to explore additional titles. To Jeff, who knows me best, you give me courage. Psalm 34:3. Women of the Word, How to Study the Bible with Both Our Hearts and Our Minds by Jen Wilkin. Foreword by Matt Chandler. When the Holy Spirit opened my eyes to believe, it was like being run over by a train. I fell in love with Jesus that night and have yet to get over it. But although my heart was aflame, my mind was empty. I asked hundreds of questions that night and in the following days. In God's gracious providence, He put a man in my life who was willing to teach me early on what the Bible was. This quote from Ed Clowney encapsulates what I learned in those early days. There are great stories in the Bible, but it is possible to know Bible stories, yet miss the Bible's story. The Bible has a storyline. It traces an unfolding drama. The story follows the history of Israel, but it does not begin there, nor does it contain what you would expect in a national history. If we forget the storyline, we cut the heart out of the Bible. Sunday school stories are then told as tamer stories of the Sunday comics, where Samson substitutes for Superman. David becomes a Hebrew version of Jack the Giant Killer. No, David is not a brave little boy who isn't afraid of the big bad giant. He is the Lord's anointed. God chose David as a king after His own heart in order to prepare for David's great son, our deliverer and champion. Over the last 20 years, the Holy Spirit has used the scriptures to encourage me, rebuke me, shape my marriage, my parenting, my approach to money, and my outlook in the midst of tragedy, and to repeatedly draw my eyes to the one whom the Bible is about. I find in my heart a passion for people to see and savor the God of the Bible, and a corresponding frustration when I see the hurt, loss, and lack of confidence that accompanies a lack of biblical literacy. That's why I'm glad you're holding this book. Jen Wilkin takes knowing the God of the Bible seriously. She is one of the better Bible teachers I've had the opportunity to hear. Her approach in teaching people how to grow in their knowledge of the Scriptures is accessible and helpful, regardless of whether you've been a Christian for decades and feel like it's too late for you, or you're a young believer who is hungry to know and understand the God of the Bible. Her 5 P's of purpose, perspective, patience, process, and prayer will serve you well in the days, weeks, and months ahead. I am confident that as you learn and practice Jen's study methods, you will be enthralled by both the Bible's stories and its story, and you will be forever changed as you come to know the hero of that story. Christ is All, Matt Chandler, Lead Pastor, The Village Church, President, Acts 29 Church Planting Network. Introduction. A Chinese proverb asks, "How do you move a mountain?" and answers, "One spoonful of dirt at a time." This is a book about moving a mountain. The mountain is my own, though I admit that I overlooked its existence until I was in my 20s. I suspect it may be your mountain as well, but you'll have to decide that for yourself. Unlike Pike's Peak or Kilimanjaro, this mountain does not immediately announce itself to our vision. It takes time to see. Thankfully, unlike a real mountain, this one can be moved. That's a good thing, because there is something unspeakably beautiful to behold on the other side. If there were such a thing as a church pedigree, mine would read, "Mixed Breed." I spent my childhood searching for a church to call home, following one or the other of my parents, who divorced when I was 9, to their current places of worship. I logged significant time in 7 different denominations, during which I went to Sunday schools, vacation Bible schools, youth groups, and retreats. I was sprinkled as an infant and immersed as a teen. I sang hymns from hymnals set to organ music, and I sang praise songs from projection screens set to guitar music. I learned to raise my hands in worship, and I learned to keep them at my sides. I heard sermons read in monotones and sermons shouted with vigor. I learned the cadence of creeds and liturgies, as well as the cadence of tambourines and dancing. I learned to have a quiet time. and memorized numerous Bible verses to earn a free trip to summer camp. I learned how to share the gospel with my lost friends. I was a church kid, albeit a kid of many churches, and I could give answers to Sunday school questions that made my teachers beam with pride. In college, I continued my denominational travels, reading devotional books and attending Bible studies to fan the flames of my faith. By my senior year, I had been asked to lead a study, but I carried a secret not uncommon to people with my background. I didn't know my Bible. Sure, I knew parts of it. I remembered stories from vacation Bible school, and I could quote verses from all over the New Testament and Psalms. But I didn't know how the parts that I knew fit with each other, much less how they fit with the parts I didn't know yet. Looming in my peripheral vision was a mountain of biblical ignorance that was just beginning to cause me concern. Though I treasured what I knew, I was growing troubled by what I did not know. Spending time in all those different churches had taught me the worrying truth that all pastors had much to say, but not all pastors were saying the same things. Who was right? Was there a rapture or not? Did God have to answer our prayers if we prayed a certain way? Did I need to be baptized again? How old is the earth? Were Old Testament believers saved differently than New Testament believers? For the most part, my teachers sounded equally convincing. How could I know who was properly interpreting the Bible and who was teaching error? Learning firsthand the painful fallout of wrong teaching sparked in me a desire to know for myself what the Bible taught. Marriage and motherhood increased my sense of urgency to learn, revealing how ill-equipped I was to fill those roles in God-honoring ways. But I didn't know where to begin to fix the problem. It seemed beyond obvious that if God had given us His revealed will in the Bible, I should be spending more time trying to know and understand it. But the task seemed overwhelming. Where was I supposed to start? And why weren't the things I was already doing making the problem discernibly better? How was I supposed to move the mountain of my biblical ignorance? The answer, of course, was gloriously simple. The answer was one spoonful at a time. Thankfully, someone gave me a spoon. I admit that I went to my first women's Bible study looking for adult conversation and coffee cake, not necessarily in that order. The siren call of free childcare was more than this young mother with a three-month-old could resist. So I went to get out of the house and get back into the land of the living. What I found was a thing of sweetness, a group of like-minded women to connect with in community, prayer, and study. What I found, though I didn't know it at the time, was the beginning of a process that would transform me from student to teacher, leaving me lying awake in my bed at night, plotting how to get more spoons into the hands of more women, praying that many mountains might be thrown into the sea. This book intends to equip you with the best spoon I can offer. It intends to teach you not merely a doctrine, concept, or storyline, but a study method that will allow you to open up the Bible on your own. It intends to challenge you to think and to grow using tools accessible to all of us, whether we hold a high school diploma or a seminary degree, whether we have minutes or hours to give to it each day. This book intends to change the way you think about Bible study. Perhaps your story is not like mine at all. Perhaps you have spent your entire life in the same church or in no church at all. My guess is that you know the dim discomfort of living in the shadow of a mountain. It has been said that we become what we behold. I believe there is nothing more transformative to our lives than beholding God and His Word. After all, how can we conform to the image of a God we haven't beheld? On the other side of the mountain of my biblical ignorance was a vision of God high and lifted up, a vision stretching from Genesis to Revelation that I desperately needed to see. I have by no means removed that whole mountain from my line of sight, but I intend to go to my grave with dirt beneath my nails and a spoon clutched in my fist. I am determined that no mountain of biblical ignorance will keep me from seeing Him as clearly as my 70 or 80 years on this earth will allow. So this is a book for those who are ready to start digging. This is a book for those who are ready to face squarely the mountain of their fragmented understanding of Scripture and, brandishing a spoon, command it to move. Chapter 1, Turning Things Around. All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. 2 Timothy 3:16-17. This is a book about equipping women through Bible study. Outside of my family, it's the thing I care most about. But this hasn't always been the case. Long before I had a passion for teaching the Bible, I had a deep and abiding passion for something else. 4-year-old me had a passion for rumba tights. You remember rumba tights, those tights for little girls made extra fancy by 4 rows of ruffled lace sewn across the seat? I absolutely loved them. I wore dresses to preschool every day so I could wear my special tights. When I ran out of dresses, undeterred, I crammed those tights under my jeans. Bulky? Yes. Uncomfortable? Absolutely. Beautiful? You know it. I loved everything about them, except for one thing. The ruffles were in the back where the wearer could not enjoy seeing them. All that beautiful lace out of eyesight? Unacceptable. But a simple solution presented itself. I began wearing them backwards. Problem solved. Until my mother caught on. I don't know if it was the heel section of the foot flopping out of the top of my Mary Janes, or the way my stomach bulged suspiciously beneath my skirt. Maybe it was the funny way I had to walk to keep them from falling down, or my frequent habit of twirling in front of mirrors. Let's just say that wearing my rumba tights backwards presented some coverage issues that wearing them correctly did not. My mother informed me that improper usage was not an option. Rumba tights were made to be worn a particular way for a particular purpose, and I either needed to turn them around or give up the privilege of those 4 glorious rows of lace. I wish I could say this was the only time in my life I got something backwards. It wasn't. In fact, my passion for teaching women the Bible is actually the result of getting other things backwards as well. I want to tell you about 2 approaches I took to being equipped by Scripture that seemed right at the outset, but were completely backwards. It might seem that studying the Bible would be something we should know how to do intuitively. After all, if God discloses His will and character there, wouldn't the Holy Spirit just open up its message to our hearts? But this is not the case. Yes, the Holy Spirit opens the Word to us, but not without some effort on our part. Do you know that the word disciple means learner? As a disciple of Christ, you and I are called to learn, and learning requires effort. It also requires good study methods. We know this to be true of our schooling, but do we know it to be true of following Christ? Though I was a good student in school, I was not always a good student of the Word, and left to my own devices, I probably would not have become one. But through the faithful teaching of others, my tendency to get a good thing backwards came to light. Turning around my 2 backwards approaches to Bible study started me toward a lifelong love of learning, applying, and teaching. Turnaround 1. Let the Bible speak of God. The first thing I got backwards seems so obviously backwards that it's embarrassing to admit. I failed to understand that the Bible is a book about God. The Bible is a book that boldly and clearly reveals who God is on every page. In Genesis, it does this by placing God as the subject of the creation narrative. In Exodus, it places Him in comparison to Pharaoh and the gods of Egypt. In the Psalms, David extols the Lord's power and majesty. The prophets proclaim His wrath and justice. The Gospels and epistles unfold His character in the person and work of Christ. The book of Revelation displays His dominion over all things. From beginning to end, the Bible is a book about God. Perhaps I really did know that the Bible was a book about God, but I didn't realize that I wasn't reading it as if it were. This is where I got things backwards. I approached my study time asking the wrong questions. I read the Bible asking, "Who am I and what should I do?" And the Bible did answer these questions in places. Ephesians 2:10 told me that I was God's workmanship. The Sermon on the Mount told me to ask for daily bread and to store up treasure in heaven. The story of King David told me to seek after the heart of God. But the questions I was asking revealed that I held a subtle misunderstanding about the very nature of the Bible. I believed that the Bible was a book about me. I believed that I should read the Bible to teach me how to live and to assure me that I was loved and forgiven. I believed it was a roadmap for life and that in any given circumstance, someone who truly knew how to read and interpret could find a passage to give comfort and guidance. I believed the purpose of the Bible was to help me. In this belief, I was not so different from Moses standing before the burning bush on Mount Sinai. Immediately within his view was a revelation of the character of God, a bush in flames, speaking audibly to him, miraculously not consumed. When charged by this vision of God to go to Pharaoh and demand release of the captives, Moses self-consciously replies, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the children of Israel out of Egypt?" God responds by patiently making himself the subject of the narrative. "But I will be with you." Rather than be reassured by this answer, Moses next asks, "What should I do?" Then Moses said to God, "If I come to the people of Israel and say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' what shall I say to them?" Notice that rather than telling Moses what he should do, God instead tells him what he has done, is doing, and will do. God said to Moses, "I am who I am." And he said, "Say this to the people of Israel, 'I am has sent me to you.'" God also said to Moses, "Say this to the people of Israel, 'The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and thus I am to be remembered throughout all generations. Go and gather the elders of Israel together and say to them, 'The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob, has appeared to me saying, I have observed you and what has been done to you in Egypt, and I promise that I will bring you up out of the affliction of Egypt. And they will listen to your voice, and you and the elders of Israel shall go to the king of Egypt and say to him, The Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has met with us. And now please let us go a 3 days' journey into the wilderness that we may sacrifice to the Lord our God. But I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless compelled by a mighty hand. So I will stretch out my hand and strike Egypt with all the wonders that I will do in it. After that, he will let you go. And I will give this people favor in the sight of the Egyptians. And when you go, you shall not go empty." Exodus 3:14-22. The dialogue continues in this manner for an entire chapter and a half of Exodus. Moses asks the wrong questions. Who am I? What should I do? Rather than answer him, "Moses, you are my chosen servant. You are my precious creation, a gifted and wise leader." God responds by completely removing Moses from the subject of the discussion and inserting himself. He answers Moses' self-focused question of who am I with the only answer that matters: I am. We are like Moses. The Bible is our burning bush, a faithful declaration of the presence and holiness of God. We ask it to tell us about ourselves, and all the while, it is telling us about I am. We think that if it would just tell us who we are and what we should do, then our insecurities, fears, and doubts would vanish. But our insecurities, fears, and doubts can never be banished by the knowledge of who we are. They can only be banished by the knowledge of I am. We must read and study the Bible with our ears trained on hearing God's declaration of himself. Does this mean that the Bible has nothing to say to us about who we are? Not at all. We just go about trying to answer that question in a backwards way. The Bible does tell us who we are and what we should do, but it does so through the lens of who God is. The knowledge of God and the knowledge of self always go hand in hand. In fact, there can be no true knowledge of self apart from the knowledge of God. He is the only reference point that is reliable. So when I read that God is long-suffering, I realize that I am not long-suffering. When I read that God is slow to anger, I realize that I am quick to anger. When I read that God is just, I realize that I am unjust. Seeing who he is shows me who I am in a true light. A vision of God, high and lifted up, reveals to me my sin and increases my love for him. Grief and love lead to genuine repentance, and I begin to be conformed to the image of the one I behold. If I read the Bible looking for myself in the text before I look for God there, I may indeed learn that I should not be selfish. I may even try harder not to be selfish. But until I see my selfishness, through the lens of the utter unselfishness of God, I have not properly understood its sinfulness. The Bible is a book about God. As Moses would learn during the Exodus, who he was bore no impact on the outcome of his situation. Who God was made all the difference. In the New Testament, we find Jesus addressing the same problem with the Jewish leaders. You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life, and it is they that bear witness about me, yet you refuse to come to me that you may have life. John 5:39-40. The Jewish leaders searched the scriptures asking the wrong question, looking for the wrong image to be revealed. If eternal life is found in the scriptures, it is found through the lens of who God is. If our reading of the Bible focuses our eyes on anyone other than God, we have gotten backwards the transformation process. Any study of the Bible that seeks to establish our identity without first proclaiming God's identity will render partial and limited help. We must turn around our habit of asking, "Who am I?" We must first ask, "What does this passage teach me about God?" Before we ask it to teach us anything about ourselves, we must acknowledge that the Bible is a book about God. Turnaround 2. Let the mind transform the heart. The second thing I got backwards in my approach to the Bible was the belief that my heart should guide my study. The heart, as it is spoken of in Scripture, is the seat of the will and emotions. It is our feeler and our decision maker. Letting my heart guide my study meant that I looked for the Bible to make me feel a certain way when I read it. I wanted it to give me peace, comfort, or hope. I wanted it to make me feel closer to God. I wanted it to give me assurance about tough choices. Because I wanted the Bible to engage my emotions, I spent little time in books like Leviticus or Numbers, and much time in books like the Psalms and the Gospels. The Bible commands us to love God with all of our hearts, Mark 12:30. When we say that we love God with all of our hearts, we mean that we love Him completely with our emotions and with our wills. Attaching our emotions to our faith comes fairly naturally for women. Generally speaking, we know how to be emotive without much guidance. If we think of the heart as the seat of our emotions and our will, it makes sense that we so often approach God's Word asking, "Who am I and what should I do?" Those two questions uniquely address the heart. And we speak often in the church about how Christianity is a religion of the heart, of how Christ comes into our hearts, of how we need heart change. It is right to speak of Christianity in this way, but not exclusively in this way. Interestingly, the same verse that commands us to love God with all of our hearts.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.